room, and the buckets of water went on there, and she had an old lace curtain that she used to put over the buckets to keep the flies out. You were not allowed to touch that water. That was for drinking and cooking only. Outside under the bough shed, there was a canvassy, hessian-y type water bag that held water. It kept it cool when the breeze, or whatever breeze came onto it, it sort of cooled it down. And there was an old pint, an enamel pint. Or a lot of the Aboriginal people made pints out of the jam tins. They put handles on them. They welded handles onto the jam tins and made pints. So those pints hung on the old water bag, and that's where you had a drink. No ice blocks then, no fridges, okay? So things were very primitive and things were very hard. I spoke to you about babies getting sick in the summertime from gastroenteritis. When I did the research of the Ngindi Babli Tubra section of the Moree Cemetery, where all the Aboriginal people were segregated, there was a Reverend Border, Church of England minister back in 1940. He decided, whatever his motive was, he decided that all Aboriginal people who were Church of England would be buried in one section. That is the Ngindi Babli Tubra section that I researched. There are 217 people buried in 214 graves. In those days, because there was no machinery to dig the graves had to be dug by hand, which meant they only went down about 4 foot. You could not bury another person on top of the other, because when it rained or it flooded, the coffins would rise, okay? So what happened was, in that section, I researched, I found 70 babies buried who died from gastroenteritis, okay? That was only the Church of England section. I'm not taking into consideration the Presbyterian, the Catholic, all those different religions that other Aboriginal people were and buried their children. So in one row down there, if you should go to the cemetery, that'd be a good little excursion for you one day, to go down to the cemetery, to the Indigenous section, I'll go with you, and you will see one row where there are 22 graves in one row. The only adult person buried in that row is old Mrs. Whitfield, Vera Whitfield. She is the grandmother of Raymond Whitfield, okay? She died and she is the only adult in that row. All the 21, there are 21 babies buried in that row, and I call her the mother of them all. I think I look upon her as looking after all those little babies in that row. So things were very, very hard for Aboriginal people when we were growing up. You didn't have the things, the facilities, you didn't have the drugs. My sister, who was a year older than what I was, the year that I was born, 1940, she died in 1941. I was 1 year old when she died. She got an ear infection, and in those days, in the mastoid part of the ear, which is a little tiny bones that are right within your skull, she got an infection, and in those days they didn't have the drugs that they have today to treat that, and she died. She was only two when she died. So she's buried in that Aboriginal section of the Moree Cemetery, okay? There's quite a few people there, most likely that all of you would be related to. I think the saddest part about it is that not a lot of the Aboriginal people have gone down to identify or put plaques on those people's graves. So it would be wonderful as an excursion to go down with some chalk maybe one day and just mark them out, you know, because I used to have to go down on Father's Day and Mother's Day and mark them out, but I was unlucky there one time. It rained and just washed them all away overnight, so it was a wasted effort. But I think we should be starting to encourage people to go down and put the names on all those graves, because I do have a list of all those people who were buried there. So it was very, very hard for Aboriginal people. When they went anywhere, they didn't have taxis. They had to either walk or they rode a bike. If you got sick, you sent a person who was a good runner, like your age, to go up and tell old Ma Smith to come. I was born at the top camp. I came quickly, and so was Tomo French. You all know Tomo French?
Yeah.
Tomo French was also born at the top camp, okay? So old Ma Smith would come when anyone was sick. When Percy Duncan and Les Duncan lived down there, they also got sick. Uncle Les got sicker than Percy. He nearly died. He had scarlet fever. And old Mrs. Smith, Ma Smith, came down and nursed him. And she got two doctors to go down there and look at him. It's the only time we ever knew of a doctor, Dr. Hunter, Dr. Hollingsworth, went down, okay, to the hut, and only for Ma Smith calling them in, he would never have survived. He went on to marry Connie, Auntie Connie, Grady, Wallace, and they had Owen and Lancy and Aubrey and Alf. They had all those boys. They had Tibby and Anna, the twins, and they had Christine. So they had a large family. But because of Ma's expertise, she knew that he wouldn't survive the night unless she got the doctors. And the doctors came and they got him through it. So, but scarlet fever always leaves you with some sort of ailment, like it weakens your heart. So even though he had a weak heart, he still survived and lived quite a long age. There was a McMaster ward, which is a special ward for Aboriginal people at the back of the hospital because we were segregated. Moree was the only town in Australia that had a written municipal act banning people of Aboriginal appearance. And then that was in 1930. And then the council, in their wisdom, also had another written act banning Aboriginal people from all the buildings and the baths. Okay? So that's why Charlie Perkins came here in 1965, because Walgett had a colour bar, Kempsey had a colour bar. Wherever Aboriginal people lived back in those days, in the 40s, 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s, there was a colour bar. I grew up during the colour bar. If anybody ever says to you that there is no colour bar in Moree, you send them to me. I grew up in the colour bar. My father was Aboriginal. We used to go to the butcher shop, which is old Mr. Tatum. You know that yellowy looking building there next to, down from the East Moree post office there? It's a yellowy looking building. I think the man who had the TV shop, he used to be in there. That was where the butcher shop used to be. There were no other shops but Bassos there, the cafe, Bassos Cafe on the corner there, and this butcher shop. That was when I was growing up, and they had a fence there. And I would ride my bike up there and stand my bike up, and Daddy would stand his bike up. And when we went into the butcher shop, we had to stand back and wait until every other white person was served. It was the same in all the shops. You went into cafes, we knew what shops to go into because our parents would say, don't go in there because they won't serve you. We learned where to go and where not to go. So when you got sick, you went to the McMaster ward. Okay?
Jane, sorry.
Hello.
Yana.
Yana. So that's
13 minutes.
So that's where you went if you got sick, and the Aboriginal people looked after all their own people. Now, if you were out at Mungandai living, okay, and you had relatives in Moree, the people at Mungandai would ring up to the hospital and say to the matron, can you take a message across to the McMaster ward? Because that was how they got messages. It was a meeting place. You went up there of a morning, if anything was wrong, there was an outpatient section. You sat there, you spoke to one another, and you knew who was sick, you knew who was in the hospital.